And welcome to this event. My name is Anne-Gaëlle Salio. I'm an associate professor of Romance Studies, and I'm the director of the Center for French and African Studies at Duke. Just a few words about the organization. This is going to be a true bilingual event. Jean-Luc Nancy will give his talk in French with simultaneous translation into English. And I'm very grateful for Amanda Gann, a PhD candidate at Harvard, to be serving as interpreter today. I think we are very, very lucky. Then following Jean-Luc Nancy's talk, we will take responses in English from my colleagues, Michael Hart, and literature graduate student, Melissa Karp, and then questions from the audience. You can use the chat feature to send your questions in both English and French after the talk. Please note that this event is recorded, so please switch off your video. It should be done automatically, but for some reason, for some of you, the video is still on, but make sure that you switch off your video. And before we start, I would like to remind everyone that this online event, like all events organized by the center, are made possible thanks to institutional support, including funding from the cultural services of the French Embassy and the Office of the Dean of Arts and Sciences at Duke. And it's a great honor to be welcoming Jean-Luc Nancy today for our online transatlantic series on inequity and its contemporary forms. I'm nevertheless left with the difficult task of introducing him, Jean-Luc Nancy, knowing very well that he's the kind of person for whom an introduction is often said to be hardly required. And Jean-Luc Nancy was not himself of great help, since when I asked him to provide me with a bio, he sent me only two pieces of information, that he was born in 1940 and that he's professor emeritus at the Marbleur University in Strasbourg. We can add that he has also been a visiting professor at several foreign universities, like UCLA or Berlin Freie Universität. That is the co-director of the series La Philosophie en Effect, Philosophy in Effect for Edition Galilée, as well as a member of the editorial board of Espace Maurice Blanchot and the Scientific Committee for Complete Works of Emmanuel Levinas. In his works, that's something maybe a bit more personal that I can add, reflection on the arts and collaboration with artists have been of primary importance, and I can attest that Jean-Luc Nancy has always been extremely grateful with artists during his career, be they musicians, dancers, and filmmakers. We can safely say that Jean-Luc Nancy is one of the most important thinkers within post-Heideggerian European philosophy. He has famously reopened the questions of the grounds of community and politics with his work La Communauté des œuvres, the inoperative community, to which Maurice Blanchot and Giorgio Agamben responded with the innovable community and the coming community, respectively. He was the subject of Jacques Derrida's only book dedicated to a contemporary philosopher, entitled Jean-Luc Nancy, Le Toucher, and he has written numerous books, and I'm just going to cite just a few. The Sense of the Word, Being Singular Plural, The Deconstruction of Christianity, The Adoration. His books have been translated into several languages and have appeared in several countries, the US, Italy, Japan, Germany, Russia, Finland, Korea, Spain. And his most recent opus is entitled La Peau Fragile du Monde, and it was published some months ago. And I think you could translate that as The World's Fragile Skin. Please join me in welcoming Jean-Luc Nancy at the Center for French and Francophone Studies for his beautifully entitled talk, The Foundation of Equality, which has very Rousseauian ring. Thank you very much. And Jean-Luc, that's...
Merci, Anne-Gaëlle. Merci pour votre invitation. Pour commencer de manière dramatique, je dirais jamais les inégalités n'ont été aussi fortes qu'aujourd'hui dans le monde. Vous le savez.
In a very dramatic way, I would say that inequalities have never been stronger than they are now in the world.
Et que pendant la Révolution française, le plus ardent défenseur de l'égalité, qui s'appelait Gracchus Babeuf, qui demandait que les pauvres soient logés dans les maisons des riches où il y avait de la place. Gracchus Babeuf a fini par être guillotiné.
And I would continue with the fact that during the French Revolution, the most ardent fighter against inequality, Gracchus Babeuf, who insisted that the poor be housed in the homes of the rich, Gracchus Babeuf ended up being guillotined.
Bien. Ensuite, pour faire juste un petit préalable, je dirais, en droit et profondément, l'égalité ne peut pas se penser sans la liberté. Et en un sens, j'aimerais garder à l'horizon de ma conférence le mot proposé par Étienne Balibar, égaliberté.
By way of introduction, I would like to say that I do not believe that the word equality can be thought without, at least on the horizon, the concept of freedom. And so I would like to keep in the background of my talk today, Étienne Balibar's concept of equi-freedom or equi-liberty. It's been translated both ways.
Oui, égalité et liberté semblent toutes les deux, nous semblent, à nous bons démocrates, à nous qui sommes censés être démocrates, égalité et liberté semblent deux évidences complètes.
Et en même temps, equality and freedom seem to us who are good Democrats or supposed to be good Democrats, equality and freedom seem to us to be two completely obvious concepts.
Donc les deux sont sans arrêt bafoués, sinon réprimés. Mais il est intéressant d'observer de quelle manière chacune des deux est bafouée ou réprimée.
So they're both incessantly undone or repressed, and it's interesting to see in which way each of them is repressed or undone.
La liberté paraît menacée ou refusée dès que l'exercice d'une autonomie individuelle est menacé. Par exemple, le port d'armes aux États-Unis ou en Europe actuellement le confinement.
So freedom seems to be refused or threatened at any point when individual autonomy is put into question, as with the right to bear arms in the United States or the lockdown confinement happening in Europe and elsewhere.
Donc c'est comme s'il n'y avait rien au-delà de l'autonomie personnelle. Au-delà de la liberté, oui, d'avoir un fusil ou de sortir de chez soi.
And so there was nothing beyond personal autonomy, the freedom to have a gun, the freedom to go outside.
L'inégalité, en revanche, c'est-à-dire le refus ou le déni de l'égalité, l'inégalité est acceptée. Pour autant que la même autonomie individuelle réussit plus ou moins selon la compétition des individus.
Inequality, however, inequality is understood as the refusal or the denial of equality is accepted, however, as long as it's happening based on the competition between individuals.
C'est la compétition des individus et la règle d'or de ce qu'est devenu aujourd'hui le mot libéralisme.
So the competition between individuals is the golden rule of what has become today known as liberalism.
Ça veut dire que on ne pense la liberté et l'égalité que sur un fond de ce que j'appellerais d'atomisme individuel.
That means that we only think of liberty or equality against a background of what I would call individual atomism.
Le rapport entre les individus, la relation est secondaire, inessentiel. Ce qui est important, ce sont les individus et la forme majeure du rapport entre eux, c'est tout simplement l'addition. L'addition des consommateurs ou l'addition des voix.
So the relationship or the relation between individuals is secondary, inessential, and is discussed only in terms of addition, amassing votes, amassing individuals.
Il est très remarquable de voir que en ce moment les États-Unis qui depuis maintenant 10 jours ne sont tout occupés par des comptes de voix. Combien de voix, qui a voté, qui n'a pas voté, bon. Sont du coup complètement éloignés, d'autant plus éloignés, je dirais, de la pensée, par exemple, de ce que pourrait être le peuple américain.
It's remarkable to see that, for example, the United States for the past 10 days, maybe more, has been obsessed with this practice of counting votes, counting how many people voted, and they, in so doing, have never been perhaps further away from what would really be a conception of the people, of the American people.
Mais c'est la même chose, je dirais, sur Instagram. Sur Instagram, qu'est-ce qui était important? C'est le nombre de likes.
Click, same thing like. As their Instagram. What's important on Instagram is the number of likes. Liking something.
Donc, le fond de cette présupposition de l'autonomie individuelle comme caractère essentiel, le fond de ça est lui-même l'équivalence générale de tout, de tous les biens, de tout ce qui peut être possédé.
So the foundation, the very foundation of this presupposition of individual autonomy is equivalency, equivalency of goods, equivalency of anything that can be possessed.
Or, l'équivalence générale, c'est la façon dont Marx désigne l'argent.
So general equivalency is the way in which Marx designates money.
Peut-être que la plus grande découverte de Marx, c'est exactement ça, c'est d'avoir découvert que le monde industriel était en train de fabriquer un monde de l'équivalence générale.
That's perhaps Marx's greatest discovery, was to understand that industrial society was developing a sense out of this general equivalency.
Or, l'équivalence n'est justement pas l'égalité.
However, equivalency is precisely not equality.
L'équivalence des voix dans le Wisconsin ou en Pennsylvanie, ou l'équivalence des likes sur le compte Instagram de X ou Y, n'ont rien à voir avec les singularités concrètes, vivantes, avec, qui sont aussi bien entendu des individualités, mais qui ne se réduisent pas à être ce qu'on appelle, ce qu'on suppose être un sujet individuel doué d'autonomie et donc ensuite capable d'accéder à tout ce qu'il pourra dans l'équivalence générale du bien par l'effet de sa liberté individuelle.
So this equivalency, this generalized equivalency of you know, of votes of in Wisconsin or Pennsylvania or of the likes on Instagram is precisely not this, you know, this singularity, which is concrete, lived, which is also in a sense an individuality, but is very different from the individual subject who, by virtue of that subject's autonomy, can participate in this wider construction.
Marx a aussi très bien compris que l'existence individuelle se trouvait du coup réduite à la force de travail disponible sur un marché du travail et devenant elle-même un bien équivalent à tous les autres biens.
So Marx also understood very well that the individual could, the subject could be reduced in the system to a workforce available in a market, a workplace, a work marketplace.
Oui, je dirais que d'abord que nous sommes dans un monde dans lequel cette équivalence générale des vies et des forces de travail est justement en train de devenir de plus en plus inégale. Les transformations actuelles du travail repoussent hors du travail nécessaire dans la société et dans la technique, dans la techno-économie actuelle, repoussent hors du travail un certain nombre de gens dont pour le moment personne ne sait comment on pourra leur redonner du travail, comment on pourra retrouver des formes de travail, ce qui veut dire aussi que le travail est lui-même entièrement réduit à la production et que par conséquent il n'a d'une certaine façon plus rien à voir avec ce que Marx considérait comme la valeur elle-même, la valeur ni d'usage ni d'échange, mais la valeur de l'homme transformant la nature.
So we're in a world where this equivalency of lives and of workforces has never been more unequal. And the way in which the techno-economy has evolved has pushed some people further and further, certain types of work and certain individuals further and further away from the possibility of work, so that we're constantly asking or we need to ask, you know, how we can find work for them or even what work they can do. And it has gone so far that we have completely reduced the idea of work to production. And so we're very far away from you know, from what Marx would have called value, so not use value or exchange value, but the value of man transforming nature.
Et encore, là, je ne parle que de nos sociétés dites développées, peut-être trop développées, hyper développées, mais qui sont en train à la fois de souffrir en elles-mêmes de ce rejet hors du travail d'un certain nombre de gens, mais qui en même temps créent pour les sociétés non développées ou en voie de développement une situation de plus en plus difficile et de plus en plus évidemment inégalitaire.
So I'm talking here only about our societies, the so-called developed societies, perhaps too developed societies or hyper-developed societies that are at the same time themselves suffering from this tendency to push individuals out of the workforce and at the same time are creating for those countries that are not as developed or developing countries, situations that are increasingly difficult.
Je dirais, si on veut, nous sommes dans une dans un monde dont l'esprit, pour parler comme Marx, l'esprit d'un monde sans esprit, dont l'esprit se limite au soi-même de chacun, ipsé. Un, deux, trois, comme nous sommes en ce moment en petit carré sur l'écran de nos ordinateurs, d'une certaine façon, sans rapport les uns avec les autres, sans rapport latéral, sans constitution d'un ensemble, non, nous ne connaissons que le ipsé de chacun.
So I would say that we're in a world where, you know, to echo Marx, that this of a spirit without spirit, and where everything is reduced only to itself, to the ipse. For example, here we're all in our own little boxes on a screen with no lateral relationships, no possibility of constituting a whole or an ensemble, but that everything is reduced to itself. Only.
Mais au nom de quoi peut-on déclarer l'égalité des ipsé, l'égalité des individus, si vous voulez?
In the name of what can we declare that there is equality among all of these different ipses, among individuals?
Au nom de quoi nous croyons le savoir. C'est pour ça que nous ne posons même pas la question. L'égalité est entendue. Tous sont égaux, au moins d'abord parce que tous sont des ipsé. Chacun est supposé être un soi-même.
We think we know in the name of what we can do this. We that's why we don't even ask ourselves the question. We think it's completely obvious why it would be that everyone is equal, because everyone is an ipse, everyone is an itself.
Et nous ne faisons même pas attention au fait que la représentation de l'ipse ou de l'ipséité, que la représentation du soi-même, du self, est elle-même une représentation complètement tributaire de notre civilisation.
We don't even take into account the fact that the representation of these ipse, of the self, this different selfhood, is a representation that depends completely upon the structures of our civilization.
Nous sommes la civilisation, et je dirais nous sommes la métaphysique même de l'ego de Descartes, qui ne veut pas dire que Descartes se réduit à ça.
We are a civilization of the ego. One could even say we're the metaphysical civilization of Descartes. Not that Descartes can be reduced only to that, but.
Alors nous savons que l'ego est très dangereux, très mauvais même, parce qu'il est facilement égoïste.
So we know that the ego is bad. You know, dangerous, maybe, because the ego can quite easily become egotistical.
Alors, nous ne manquons jamais de critiquer l'égoïsme. Nous le faisons tous les jours, sans arrêt, dans tous les journaux. C'est notre bonne conscience. L'égoïsme est mauvais.
So we never fail to criticize egotism. We do it everywhere. In every newspaper, all over the place, that is something we consider to be very bad. Egotism is bad.
Mais cette critique de l'égoïsme, je dirais, est d'autant plus, est devenue elle-même un produit de consommation. Vous pouvez trouver la critique de l'égoïsme dans tous les magazines que vous voudrez, sur toutes les chaînes de télévision, sur les radios, évidemment dans l'esprit public. Et il ne faut pas être égoïste, il faut être ouvert aux autres.
So this is our good conscience. I would say that this criticism of egotistical behavior has become itself a product for consumption. You can find it in every magazine, on every television channel, on the radio, in sort of public thought.
En même temps que ce bon discours moral de l'égalité et du non-égoïsme est partout répandu, en même temps, maintenant, Macron et Merkel viennent de refuser l'idée d'une taxation des transactions financières.
So even though this the idea of not being egotistical is published everywhere and is supposed to be accepted as universally true, Macron and Merkel have just denied the idea of taxing financial transactions.
Ce n'est qu'un aspect de ce n'est qu'un aspect du contraste, de la contradiction énorme qu'il y a aujourd'hui entre les processus réels du pouvoir qui n'est pas du tout un pouvoir d'abord politique, qui est d'abord un pouvoir techno-économique. Donc, entre les processus réels de ce pouvoir et la prétention morale, je dirais franchement idéologique, de l'égalité et de la condamnation de l'égoïsme.
So this is only one aspect of what is the immense contradiction today between real processes, which are the result of, I wouldn't even say first political, but techno-economic power and the exercise of that power through real processes, and what I would call a moral or even ideological pretension to equality and non-egoism.
Alors, dans quelle situation sommes-nous? Je dirais, nous sommes, alors cette fois, pardon, pour parler comme Sartre, je dirais, nous sommes dans une situation de mauvaise foi. Nous sommes dans une situation de conscience double. D'un côté, nous affirmons l'égalité. De l'autre, nous la nions et nous la détruisons constamment.
So what type of situation are we in? I would say we're in a situation, to use Sartre's term, of bad faith or of double consciousness. On the one hand, we affirm equality, and on the other hand, all over the place, we are denying it and destroying it.
Seulement, il ne suffit pas de dénoncer cette contradiction. Parce que si je la dénonce, je fais la même chose que ce qui se fait, encore une fois, tous les jours dans tous les magazines.
So it's not enough, on the other hand, to just denounce, to denounce this contradiction, because if I do that, all I'm doing is producing the same behavior as what you see in the magazines every day.
Alors, quelle question faut-il poser s'il ne suffit pas, je dirais, s'il ne suffit pas de s'indigner? L'indignation a été un mot assez fort il y a quelques années en France, parce qu'il avait été lancé par un ancien résistant avec les meilleures intentions du monde. Donc le mot d'ordre était devenu « indignez-vous ». Et nous, nous indignons tout le temps.
So what question are we supposed to ask? Not enough just to be indignant. This word indignation became very visible in France. It was thrown out by a former resistance fighter for very good cause, perhaps at that time, but was indignez-vous, so become indignant, be outraged. But in fact, what happens is that we're outraged all the time.
Alors, je crois, on en arrive à ceci que la seule attitude, je ne dirais même pas philosophique, pas philosophique en tout cas au sens de la spécialité de la philosophie, la seule attitude rationnelle et la seule attitude d'une personne pensante, c'est de faire autre chose que de s'indigner, c'est-à-dire de se questionner, de se demander où est la faiblesse, puisqu'il y a une faiblesse manifeste de notre affirmation de l'égalité, une faiblesse qui est de plus en plus faible en face d'une force de plus en plus grande de l'inégalité.
So what attitude can we take if it's not enough to be outraged? And I think the only attitude that we can take, and it's not even a philosophical attitude in the sense of that as a specialty, but I would say it's a rational attitude or the attitude of the thinking person, which is to question oneself, to ask oneself, where is the weakness in our concept of equality? Because it is a large weakness and it is becoming weaker and weaker the more that equality is subverted, the more that inequality grows.
Au fond, je pense que maintenant la première chose à faire serait de faire cette provocation de dire pourquoi pas l'inégalité. Pourquoi pas reconnaître qu'il y a des inégalités, qu'elles soient naturelles ou qu'elles soient produites par un système social, technique. Il y a des inégalités, il faut les accepter, c'est... voilà.
So I think the first thing to do would be to throw out the provocation of why not inequality? Why not recognize and accept that there are inequalities, natural or produced by social or technological forces, to recognize that inequalities exist and to accept that they're there? Why not do that?
Pourquoi pas? Alors, on répondra, ah, mais vous n'y pensez pas, parce qu'il y a une égalité naturelle.
So to the answer of why not, one might say, oh, well, you're not really thinking about it because there is a natural equality.
Justement, nous sommes dans une époque qui est en train de détruire de fond en comble la nature, ou du moins de la transformer, de la dénaturer, de telle manière qu'il est assez difficile de se réclamer de quelque chose comme une loi naturelle.
Precisely, we're in an era where we are destroying what is natural from top to bottom, or at least we are transforming it to such a degree that it's becoming denatured. So it's quite difficult to credibly claim that there are such a thing as natural laws.
Donc il faudrait peut-être partir tout simplement de ceci, qui serait sûrement une autre provocation pour le bon sens commun. L'égalité des hommes n'est pas naturelle.
So perhaps we have to start from this premise, which is doubtless another provocation to at least good common sense, which is to begin with the idea that equality among humans is precisely not natural.
Mais pourquoi n'est-elle pas naturelle? Parce que rien d'humain n'est naturel.
Et ça, why isn't it natural? Nothing that is human is natural.
Ça, c'est ce que nous sommes en train d'apprendre, parce que nous apprenons à quel point justement, nous transformons nous-mêmes la nature. Nous sommes issus de la nature, nous sommes des animaux, nous sommes une espèce animale qui est douée du pouvoir particulier de justement changer la nature d'où elle est issue.
So why is it the case that nothing that human is natural? Well, it's because we have come from nature. We are an animal species, but we are an animal species that is capable of power to change precisely what is natural, everything that surrounds us.
Alors, nous devons nous demander si l'égalité n'est pas naturelle. Ce qui soit dit en passant, est tout de même aussi visible, sensible, palpable, parce que tous les êtres humains ne naissent pas de la même taille, de la même forme, doués des mêmes propriétés physiologiques.
Donc, so we have to ask ourselves if this equality isn't natural, and let me just say in passing that it's quite visible, palpable in the mere fact that not all humans are born with the same physiological properties, the same height, the same shape.
Donc, qu'est-ce que nous pouvons trouver comme teneur à l'idée d'égalité?
What content can we find for this idea of equality then?
Premièrement, il faut constater qu'il n'y a eu à peu près aucune société égalitaire dans l'histoire du monde avant l'Occident.
First, we have to state this fact that there has been no, virtually no egalitarian society in the history of the world before the West.
Je sais, on pourra venir m'objecter un certain nombre de peuples, en général très restreints, évidemment, comme, je ne sais pas, certains peuples d'Amazonie, peut-être d'autres, qui apparemment présentent tous les caractères d'une réelle égalité. C'est vrai.
So people might object, and it's true that there are certain peoples, usually very small groups of people, who seem to be living in a way that shows characteristics of a real equality. Tribes in the Amazon, for example, or others, but small groups of people, and that's true.
Et Dieu sait si nous avons rêvé d'une espèce de retour à une existence comme celle de ces Indiens d'Amazonie. Par exemple, Pierre Clastre a rêvé de ça et en a parlé très bien.
And God knows we've imagined some type of return to this way of living. Pierre Clastre imagined such a thing. That we could live as these indigenous tribes, and he spoke very well about it.
Et le mot communisme a été inventé bien avant Marx par Rétif de la Bretonne. Il a été inventé comme étant ce qu'on pensait être le mode d'existence réel de certaines tribus d'Amérique du Sud, qu'en fait on ne connaissait pas, mais sur lesquels on avait entendu des choses où il y avait eu des récits. Donc le communisme, ça paraissait comme la forme entièrement égalitaire, et de l'existence d'une sorte d'humanité originelle, naturelle, primitive.
So the word communism was coined well before Marx by Rétif de la Bretonne, who was using it to talk about the way of life of certain tribes in South America, which of course, with which they'd had no contact, but had heard stories about them. When this was how they imagined that they were living. So this word communism is this idea of complete egalitarianism.
Je dirais que l'échec ou la fin du communisme, en tout cas du communisme réel ou de tous les communismes réels, cet échec ou cette fin, c'est l'échec et la fin d'une pensée naïve et naturaliste de l'égalité humaine.
So the failure of communism, of all communisms or real communist regimes, is in a sense the failure of this naive, naturalistic conception that somehow there would be a return to a fantasy way of living as an indigenous or primitive or natural human way of existing.
Alors, qu'est-ce que nous avons pour saisir la teneur de l'égalité? D'abord, on va tout de suite dire Athènes, la démocratie grecque. C'est faux, car la démocratie grecque est une démocratie inégalitaire. Il y a l'égalité de tous les, disons pour simplifier, de tous les propriétaires et inégalité complète des femmes, des esclaves, bien sûr.
So what are we going to use to describe the content of equality? Right away, someone's going to say Athens, but that's wrong, because Athens was, yes, a democracy, but an unequal democracy. So perhaps there may have been a certain equality among property holders, yes, but radical inequality in terms of women and slaves, yes. Slaves.
En fait, le premier concept historique élaboré et avec une portée évidemment juridique et politique effective de l'égalité, c'est le concept romain, c'est le concept du droit romain, du citoyen romain.
So the first historical concept of equality that had a legal and political impact was that of rights and citizenship in Roman society.
Seulement, le droit romain n'a jamais eu l'intention de changer la société pour en faire une société égalitaire. Le droit romain était une technique. Une technique d'administration, de gestion d'une très grande quantité de population sur de très grands territoires. Et donc, cette égalité entièrement formelle donnait bien entendu des droits. On avait le droit, même si on était, un Syrien, un Juif, un germain, et qu'on était citoyen romain, on avait le droit de relever de la justice romaine, bien. Mais.
The problem, this Roman law was never attempting to change society or to make anything equal. It was a technique of management, administration applied to a large population over a large territory. And so, yes, in a sense, there was some sort of formal equality, and that from the moment that one was a citizen, whether Syrian or Frank or Jewish, they could appeal to the Roman legal procedure.
Alors, quand est-ce qu'est apparue une égalité non seulement formelle? C'est-à-dire, comme on peut le dire, une égalité matérielle ou substantielle.
So when did something that was not, an equality that was not purely formal, an equality that was material or one could say substantive, when did that appear?
Il est très intéressant de constater que c'est le christianisme qui introduit la première notion d'égalité substantielle. Car tous les hommes sont égaux parce qu'ils sont tous fils de Dieu.
So it's interesting to note that Christianity was really the first moment where there is a substantive conception of equality. All men are equal because they are all the sons of God.
Et je suis persuadé que de ce point de vue, comme de beaucoup d'autres points de vue, le christianisme montre ainsi qu'il était le résultat résultat d'un malaise profond de la société romaine, qui même avec son égalité formelle et avec toutes ces énormes capacités, encore une fois, je dirais, techniques, et ces énormes réussites, qui était une société de désarroi, d'inquiétude.
And that's why I'm convinced that Christianity is a product of a deep malaise within Roman society, because we, even with all this formal equality and all of these mechanisms, which were technical and in fact tremendously successful in a certain way, it must have been a society that was profoundly marked by uncertainty and concern and worry.
Seulement, évidemment, l'égalité chrétienne, qui était toute spirituelle, elle était substantielle, mais spirituelle, ne changeait rien à la condition réelle des gens. Mais la question ne se posait pas encore. Et la question a commencé à se poser, eh bien, lorsque les hommes de l'Europe ont commencé à ne plus être seulement les fils de Dieu, mais lorsqu'ils sont devenus, au contraire, leurs propres producteurs.
So this equality in Christianity was, of course, only spiritual. It was substantive, but spiritual, and therefore changed nothing about the material conditions of life. So the interest in a material change came only when people became something different from just the children of God and became individuals who were themselves producers.
Alors, à ce moment-là, l'égalité substantielle, l'égalité des créatures de Dieu devait devenir une autre égalité, une égalité de conditions d'existence. Donc, tendanciellement, une égalité de richesse, puisqu'on était dans un monde dans lequel la richesse, c'est l'auto-production et l'auto-augmentation de la richesse, était devenue la loi.
So at that point, the conception of equality as equality among creatures of God had to become equality of conditions, because we're in a world where being the auto-accumulation and auto-production of wealth and auto-accumulation of wealth had become the order of the day.
Et c'est là, pour aller extrêmement vite, bien sûr, faire un raccourci, c'est là qu'on retrouve Marx. Parce que Marx est le premier qui va chercher à donner à l'égalité substantielle une substance réelle, à savoir la valeur du travail.
And so this is where we get back to Marx. I'm going very quickly, putting a little shortcut here, but Marx is the first to try to give to this substantive equality of material substance, which is for him the value of work.
Or, premièrement, l'échec ou la fin du communisme, c'est aussi l'échec, la fin, ça n'avait jamais commencé, d'une réduction des niveaux de richesse entre les travailleurs et ceux qui les font travailler, ceux qui achètent leur force de travail. D'abord, et la situation extraordinaire d'inégalité dans laquelle nous sommes aujourd'hui est exactement, je veux dire, le résultat, je ne dis pas du tout le résultat de Marx, ce n'est pas la faute de Marx, mais c'est le résultat de l'impossibilité où toute la civilisation a été, au fond, de trouver ce qu'était la valeur du travail, de le trouver autrement que comme une valeur elle-même marchande, donc équivalente.
So the end or the failure, I'll say not end because it never really began, but the failure of communist regimes demonstrates the inability to reduce the gap between the level of wealth of those who are working and the level of wealth of those who are making them work. And it's the result of this impossibility, not the fault of Marx, but the result of this conception that we've not actually found a value of work that is any other value than a value that can be bought and sold.
Je crois que on peut dire, là aussi en raccourci, on peut dire que Marx aurait voulu pouvoir trouver, nommer, presque calculer la valeur du producteur, du travailleur, et non pas la valeur de la production, du produit, et donc de la marchandise.
I would say that, and I'm again going quickly here, but I would say that Marx would have wanted to find or name or almost even calculate the value of the producer as opposed to the value of the product and therefore the value of the merchandise.
En fait, c'est là que se joue toute l'histoire bien connue, très difficile et compliquée de ce que Marx lui-même a appelé la plus-value, la valeur apportée par le travailleur à la matière travaillée.
So there, that's where it plays out all the complicated and, you know, fraught history of what Marx called, you know, the greatest value, the value brought by the worker to the work.
La plus-value de Marx est incalculable.
And that greatest value that Marx was speaking of is incalculable.
Et dans notre civilisation tellement rationaliste, nous avons éprouvé cette impossibilité de calculer la plus-value comme un échec, comme une limite qu'il fallait accepter.
And in our extremely rationalist society, we've sort of conceived of this inability to calculate this added value as just a limit that we have to deal with.
Mais ça, c'est raisonné justement dans les termes du calcul. Donc dans les termes du calcul de productivité, de rentabilité, etc., etc.
But that's only working within the vocabulary of calculation, of calculating productivity, calculating profitability, etc.
C'est ce qui fait qu'aujourd'hui, encore une fois, dans notre monde tellement, tellement féru d'égalitarisme, nous faisons travailler pour des salaires ridicules. Nous faisons travailler dans le monde, en particulier en Asie, mais aussi en Amérique et en Europe, une quantité de gens dont on ne peut même pas dire que leur valeur de producteur n'est pas reconnue, mais la valeur même de leur production n'est pas rémunérée dans ce qu'on leur paye.
And so it's this line of reasoning that makes it such that, you know, our contemporary societies who are so attached to the concepts of equality and egalitarianism can make people work all over the world, in Asia in particular, but also in the Americas and in Europe, for salaries that go so far as to not only not recognize their value as producers, but to not even recognize the value of their production.
Alors, il y a une conclusion s'impose, c'est que il s'agit certainement, en effet, de quelque chose d'incalculable.
So there is a conclusion that sort of imposes itself, is that yes, in effect, we're dealing with something that is incalculable.
Et de quelque chose d'incalculable, de tel que cet incalculable ne peut même pas être lui-même rattrapé par un algorithme. Aujourd'hui, on fait des quantités de recherches pour élaborer des algorithmes qui puissent intégrer l'imprévisible, l'incalculable, voire l'impossible.
And so it's incalculable to such an extent that it's beyond, you know, what algorithms that are being developed could catch up to. You know, today there's feverish activity of research of algorithms that can take into account what's unpredictable, what's incalculable, even perhaps what's impossible. But this is beyond that.
Ça voudrait dire que le fondement de l'égalité est incalculable, ou plus exactement, que le fondement de l'égalité, oui, il est dans le caractère incalculable de la valeur de chaque existence humaine. Je laisse de côté les autres existences vivantes parce que ça compliquerait beaucoup le problème.
So this is to say that the foundation then of equality is perhaps in the incalculable, and more specifically in the incalculable quality of the value of each existence, and I will say human existence, because to take into account the existence of every living being would complicate matters quite a lot.
Ce qui veut dire alors qu'en un sens, il n'y a pas de fondement de l'égalité. Il n'y a pas de base sur laquelle on puisse s'appuyer comme on peut appuyer un calcul, une mesure, quelle qu'elle soit, sur une base.
So this is to say that there is no foundation of equality. There is no base from which we can calculate it. No base in the sense of a system of measure or a base that you begin from to do a calculation.
Mais alors, qu'est-ce que ça veut dire? Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire une absence de fondement? Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire une incalculabilité foncière, originaire?
So what does that mean? What does that mean for there to be an absence and fundamental, original incalculability?
Sans doute que ça a au moins un rapport avec la caractéristique la plus égalitaire entre tous les hommes, qui est la mort.
Doubtless, it has a relationship then with the characteristic that is the most egalitarian among all people, which is death.
Il est bien connu que nous mourrons tous et que Bill Gates mourra comme moi et comme le dernier des réfugiés somaliens en train d'arriver en France. Il est certain que nous mourrons tous, mais justement, notre culture est devenue une culture qui veut ignorer la mort. Que nous mourrons tous, c'est malheureux. C'est bien triste, mais il faut faire avec ça. Oui. Oui, tout le monde est prêt à dire ça. Bien sûr, nous avons toujours le sens que la mort de chacun mérite une attention, un respect. Bon. Mais c'est pas suffisant. C'est pas suffisant.
So it's well known that, you know, everyone's going to die. Bill Gates is going to die. I'm going to die. Every last Somalian refugee who has arrived in France is going to die. This is a commonplace phenomenon we acknowledge, but our society is constructed in such a way that we push aside our knowledge of death. we say, oh, you know, that's too bad or it's really sad, but we don't actually take this commonality into account. And yes, it's true that we tend to say that every death deserves a certain respect and to be treated with dignity, etc. But that's not enough.
Voilà, je dirais, oui, une preuve de ça, ce sont les transhumanistes qui veulent essayer de surmonter la mort par différents procédés. Mais s'il y a quelque chose qui est commun à tous ces désirs transhumanistes, c'est que évidemment ils sont parfaitement inégalitaires. C'est que évidemment, pour pouvoir se faire cryogénéiser et ressusciter dans un siècle, il faut beaucoup d'argent. Et beaucoup de naïveté aussi, mais beaucoup d'argent.
So the proof of this is that there is such a thing as transhumanists, you know, who are trying to transcend death in various ways. But the common point among all of them is that it is deeply unequal. That in order to have yourself cryogenized or resuscitated or whatever, you need a lot of money and also a lot of naivete, I would say.
C'est aussi, je crois, ce qui explique que tout en ayant quitté le modèle des guerres classiques, qui étaient des guerres entre les États, qui étaient des guerres qui avaient même leurs règles, nous sommes aujourd'hui dans un, c'est même pas un modèle, mais nous sommes dans une réalité qui n'est plus du tout de la guerre, qui est de la lutte de tous contre tous, partout. Et donc du recours à la possibilité de tuer de toutes les manières. Il n'y a pas que les manières militaires. Et on peut aussi tuer par le travail excessif. On peut tuer par les substances qu'on fait avaler. On peut tuer par les organismes génétiquement modifiés. Bon, aujourd'hui, on tue. On tue sans doute plus qu'autrefois, mais ce n'est pas la question, parce qu'autrefois aussi la population était moins grande. Mais aujourd'hui, on tue parce que tuer fait partie d'un processus d'avancée dans lequel, au bout du compte, on pourrait dire, survivront ceux qui auront su survivre, auront été assez malins, assez forts pour survivre.
Hmm. And so we're in a model now, unlike the classic model of war, which was of war between states with certain rules. We're in, I wouldn't even say it's a model, a situation where battles are being waged on all fronts everywhere. And one can kill through many means in many places, not only militarily, but through excessive work, through poisoning with the toxic substances, through genetically modified foods. We're killing and killing and killing. And I think probably we're killing more than we ever have before, although it's difficult to say because populations are smaller, but killing has become a part, an integral part of this process of advancement. And so at the end of the day, there's a rationale of, you know, those who survive will be the ones who knew how to survive.
Donc, je crois vraiment que la seule réponse, et je sais bien que ce n'est pas une réponse, la seule réponse, c'est que nous avons maintenant une tâche de penser la mort, je dirais, complètement à nouveau frais. Si nous ne pouvons plus penser la mort de manière religieuse, alors comment pouvons-nous la penser? C'est la question que je vous laisse en partage. Mais je voudrais seulement faire remarquer que le premier philosophe de la modernité, c'est-à-dire Hegel, le premier qui a perçu que le temps moderne était un temps gris, comme il dit, un temps privé des couleurs de la vie. Ce premier philosophe de la modernité est aussi celui qui, vous le savez bien, tout le monde le sait, c'est très connu, qui écrit « l'esprit véritable, n'est pas celui qui recule devant la mort, mais celui qui séjourne en elle. » Qui s'arrête, qui fait... Voilà. Cette phrase très fameuse de la préface de la phénoménologie de l'esprit, c'est peut-être ça qui devrait être maintenant notre objet de méditation.
So I think the only response to the question, and I know of course this isn't really a response, is that our task now is to think death in new ways. So if we can no longer use religious means to think about this question of death, then we need to figure out a new way to think death. And the first philosopher of modernity, Hegel, who perceived modern times as gray and devoid of colors and of life, was also someone who it's well known, a famous phrase from Phenomenology of Spirit, that the real spirit is the one which does not back away from death, but which sojourns within it, stops a while, think. And so I believe that this phrase, this should be our meditation at this moment.
Sans cela, je crois, c'est-à-dire, évidemment, peut-être sans une sorte de révolution philosophique ou spirituelle de notre civilisation, nous avons déjà perdu pour toujours toute égalité et en même temps toute véritable liberté.
So I think without this, without a real philosophical and spiritual revolution in our civilization, we've already lost and lost forever any possibility of equality, and with that, any possibility of freedom.
Merci.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jean-Luc Nancy. That was a fantastic talk. And thank you very much, Amanda, for your translation. Beautifully done. It's extremely hard to be translating philosopher simultaneously. And I think you've done just a remarkable job. So now we're going to take the responses from Melissa Karp and Michael Hart. Who would you like to start?
I'll go first, if that's okay, Melissa. You're looking okay, yeah, okay. I've prepared two introductory remarks or remarks about context, and then really one substantial comment. And the first, I wanted to just situate the importance of this kind of work that Jean-Luc Nancy is doing here today, but then has been doing for decades. It seems to me that the primary task of a political philosophy is to renew and struggle over our political vocabulary. Certainly it's not, when Deleuze says, or Deleuze was fond of saying, that to philosophize is to create concepts, certainly it's not just the creating of the concepts, but then struggling over the existing concepts and working with them. It seems to me often that our political vocabulary today, that the primary terms of it are all corrupt to the point of almost being unusable. And so that to work on them, as Jean-Luc Nancy does, has done for long, and again today, about freedom, equality, I would add democracy, has been so corrupt to be almost unusable that it seems to be an enormous work, and it's a great service in a way to do that. I would like to focus now more or less on the, you know, because Jean-Luc Nancy had said before that in his thought together with Etienne Balibar, freedom and equality go together. I would like to more focus on the freedom half. In fact, I'm quite interested in an aspect near the conclusion of the talk that I'm not prepared to say enough about, this notion of equality that is based on a immeasurable, incalculable foundation. Like the notion of a equality of singularities, I would say, that doesn't rely on measure. I find that super interesting, but I'm not yet prepared to say something about that. I'll have to think about that one more. Instead, I wanted to do a second sort of situation about this question about freedom and equality, recognizing the importance of what Jean-Luc Nancy is doing, like I said, both today and previously. In many ways, he's displacing some of the conventional, perhaps outdated contradictions or antinomies that have fueled these questions about freedom and equality for a long time. For instance, I mean, in the Cold War frame, for decades, there was a notion of that equality and freedom were incompatible, that you could have one or you could have the other. And this was in some ways narrativized in the Cold War frame. I mean, that the capitalist West had freedom and therefore would have to be satisfied with a certain inequality. Whereas the really existing communist states had equality, but therefore would have to be satisfied with unfreedom. You know, that one could have one or the other. But instead, and this seems exactly right, you know, that in fact, one cannot have the one without the other. I mean, this is what seems a strong claim and an important one. There's one other situating frame that seemed useful for me thinking about this, particularly thinking about the claims about freedom that Jean-Luc Nancy makes and has made, like I said, for decades. I was putting in the context of a influential, especially in Britain and the United States, essay by Isaiah Berlin, published in the late 1950s, about two concepts of liberty. It was a lecture that then was published as an essay. And the differentiator there was a notion of freedom from and freedom to. This too was thematized often in a Cold War frame or even in other political frames that freedom from was a individualist capitalist notion and that freedom to was more aligned with the some notion of liberation, I guess I would say. And also this notion, you know, Hayek was then very taken with this notion of freedom from, so a certain neoliberal conception of freedom is compatible with that in contrast to the freedom to. Now here, what seems to me most, one of the innovative things that Jean-Luc Nancy insists about here, breaking this divide, is that no one is free as an autonomous individual. No one is free alone. One is only free, I wouldn't say just in the midst of community, one is only free within a world, or even better, one is only free in the construction of a world. And that seems to me in fact, one could with a certain point in the talk just a few minutes ago, when Professor Nancy was insisting on the artificial nature of humanity, I would list it with this. I mean, this is where it seems quite compatible with this idea that the construction of a world and that freedom exists in our shared construction of a world. That seems to me super important and rich. In any case, those are just two ways for me of situating the kind of work, like I said, that Professor Nancy is doing in this talk and then has done for quite a while. I want to instead, here's the one substantive thing I have to say, really, which is that we can think freedom today in the context of two catastrophes or context of two disasters. And Jean-Luc Nancy had mentioned before and has written also other times recently about the confinement or, you know, about the sheltering at home, you know, that thinking freedom in the context of the pandemic, you know, of that catastrophe is a rich one. I would like to think for a minute about the other catastrophe and that is the Trump presidency and the way the thinking of freedom within that and what the questions are. So in fact, for me, the question then is, what does it mean for the thinking of freedom? Even the recent election, for instance, my view had been, you know, a week ago and in the recent weeks that the importance of this past presidential election in the US, the importance was really, and the way one should think about it was in terms of choosing a better enemy. Like that it's not a matter of choosing between a friend and choosing an enemy. It's thinking a better enemy and particularly a better enemy for thought. Like that's what I think the importance of a Biden election was, and I'm relatively confident that we are gonna see a Biden presidency. I think it's a better enemy for political thought. And let me try to explain why that is, that I hope I can do this in terms of freedom. For instance, one of the ways in which you can see what I mean by Trump being a bad enemy for thought is the way that one manifestation of this, let's say, was that many left intellectuals, many US left intellectuals, who for their entire careers have been rightly criticizing the US Constitution, have found themselves in recent years, me included, to defend the Constitution. I mean, in the context of the impeachment, there was a certain pressure. And many of the intellectuals, like I say, that I think all of us admire, have felt the need to defend that. Or in the context of the election, just the last few days, felt the necessity to defend democracy. Of course, democracy in its most banal electoral form, not any innovative conception of democracy. So there's a kind of defensive posture that's required by the by a politics or a political thought that has Trump as its enemy. I think instead Biden is a better enemy because he allows for a deeper and more radical thinking, and in fact, a greater multiplicity. Like one is no longer obliged to defend the corrupt versions of freedom or equality. And in fact, I would say at the top of the agenda now should be a rethinking of the project or the projects of liberation. And so that then I come actually to a question, which is, maybe this is the philosophical side of the question, is which, how does one proceed from thinking freedom to thinking liberation? In my way of conceiving things, I see liberation as different from emancipation, like whereas emancipation is a freedom of an existing subject as it is, I conceive of liberation as a freedom that also involves a subjective transformation. That as liberated, we are no longer who we were. And in fact, when I was speaking before about how Jean-Luc Nancy conceives freedom as freedom in a world, or even freedom in the construction of a world, that seems to me like a way of thinking liberation, or it's possibly one. So then that was maybe the philosophical side of, I don't know if that's a question or a comment, reflection, put it that, is the more political one, I guess, and this is maybe more US centered, so really not, I wouldn't burden Professor Nancy with having to answer this, but a question for me, let's put it that way. How does this notion of liberation, or this mandate to liberation, this movement from freedom to liberation, how does this dovetail or intersect with the many diverse political liberation projects today? Like one could think about them, one way of approaching this is not in its activist face, but in its intellectual and scholarly face. You know, for instance, our former colleague, Fred Moten, writes about like wanting to recenter freedom in the Black radical tradition, like wanting to think a Black liberation and a freedom founded on fugitivity, the tradition of fugitivity as being a basis for freedom. You know, so that would be one within the recent decades, you know, but of feminist theory, several authors wanting to recenter liberation and recenter freedom in it. I'm thinking of both Linda Zerilli primarily writing it in an Arendtian idiom, you know, following Hannah Arendt. Wendy Brown more following Nietzsche really here, but returning freedom to feminism. I guess, and the third one that I feel maybe closer, most identified with, the notion of the tradition of a freedom, of a communism as freedom from work, a heterodox communist tradition that poses liberation that way. But all of three of these, I guess I was posing these as intellectual traditions of liberation. One could name many more. And like I said, maybe it would be more useful to go to the actual activist legacies of anti-colonial notions of liberation, of the various activist forms of queer liberation and feminist liberation. I guess I'm wondering what the intersection among them can be, or what the relationship of them are or could be to this notion of freedom and the combined notion of liberation. So this is just coming back to my comment about the election. I guess this seems to be another detriment that we experience from having Trump as enemy, that there was a feeling of a need for unity, a unity against the disaster, or something like that. So now I think one of the benefits is the need for and possibility of a multiplicity of struggles that are able to compose a coherent constellation. So perhaps a shared notion of freedom or of liberation really is what makes such a composition possible among the different forms of liberation struggle. So I guess this last part, there was really just two levels of it. The philosophical question about the relationship between freedom and liberation, and the more political and I guess conjunctural, you know, the question about now issue, which is how did these concepts of freedom or liberation fit with or animate potentially existing or potential projects of liberation today? I pose it, I guess, not so much as a question that I expect Professor Nolsi to answer, but more just a reflection that his thinking opens up for me. I'll stop there.
Alors, vous n'allez pas me traduire tout ça, bien sûr, mais le peut-être la dernière, la question finale, non?
Oui, enfin, je ne sais pas s'il y avait une question. Enfin, je voulais, enfin, Angel, vous voulez qu'on procède comment? Enfin, est-ce que...
Non, mais je peux dire quelque chose, alors. Je peux dire quelque chose as far as I understood. I did not understand everything, but first, I would say, okay, I agree totally with you on the difference between freedom from and freedom to. But I would link that to the question of liberation. I agree with you that liberation is not emancipation, and all the time I think the word emancipation, which was a very important word, I know, but the word emancipation comes from the emancipation of the Roman slave, you know. So emancipation means that I was a slave. But how was I a slave before I was born? Or even a little after I was born? Well, so I agree with liberation. But you say, if I understood well, you say the liberation involves the subject itself. Okay, but it is a subject which for me is dangerous. Because what do you mean? You mean that the subject will to be liberated at the end as a full achieved subject? Or maybe we should have to understand that precisely to be a subject, to be a self, if you want, to be an ipse, like I said before, so means the capacity to come back to oneself, the capacity to have a relationship to myself. So I have a relationship to myself. I know that I am Jean-Luc Nancy. I am talking with Michael Hart. We are in a Duke University. Trump is doing that and that for his election, etc., etc. But I can go as far as you want. I never find an end with that. Who am I? What means to be a subject? So the word subject is a very terrible word because it seems to be substantial by itself. A subject that is a substance. Hegel precisely said, we shall go from the substance to the subject. But the subject is an infinite moving of the substance. And then there is no end to the liberation. You know? But for example, I've seen that every kind of liberation today, even if you take the feminist liberation, so there are discussions between feminists about what is the final goal or the final step of feminist emancipation. That equality, we'll say, equality, is that enough? Is that enough if the equality has to be sought, etc., etc.? No. So I would agree with the liberation if it is clear that there is no end to the liberation and that the final liberation, I'm sorry, but that the final liberation is a liberation toward death. But precisely at this point, we have to, I don't know, we have to think, we have to grasp something else, that, because if I say the final end is dead, say, okay, good man, where is the liberation? Precisely the liberation may be there, that is at the point where there is no question of the total free subject. So that would be my only comment.
Voilà que vous avez tout compris. Mais alors.
Non.
I would like maybe you Michael on Jean-Luc if you have on Jean-Luc Nancy if you have some things you might want to continue, but I would like to give the opportunity for Melissa Karp. To give a response as well, and also to maybe take some responses from the audience. I know it's been already 1.5 hours, so we are very tight on time. Thank you.
I'll be brief. So first, thank you so much, Dr. Nancy, for this talk. There's a lot to think about, and I hope that my response will actually dovetail on quite nicely with this previous discussion. In the discussion of equality and equivalence, and in this moment kind of of crisis, I'm very reminded of another one of Dr. Nancy's books, L'équivalence des catastrophes après Fukushima, so the equivalence of catastrophes after Fukushima. And I wanna kind of bring some of that into discussion with what we've been talking about so far. Maybe pose a couple questions of my own. I'm very much thinking of a phrase at the end of that book, a proposition of a communism of non-equivalence. And in particular, I'm thinking about non-equivalence in the terms that Dr. Nancy explained it as something that makes equivalence explicit as something where all are equal in that no one is no one is commensurable or identical with anyone else. And so I want to ask us to think a bit on the relationship between non-equivalence and equality and inequality that you've posed today, if there is a relationship, what that is. And I'll expand a little bit more on what I'm thinking about in particular. It is, as Michael pointed out, there's many catastrophes that we're experiencing right now. So we have the pandemic, the economic catastrophe that accompanies that, and then now a kind of newly arisen in a different way, perhaps than expected, political catastrophe that's continuing and rolling on. And I wanted to ask if we can consider this moment of multiple catastrophes in the same terms as Fukushima is considered in that book, where natural catastrophes and their technological or economic repercussions are made equivalent in and through this interconnected space of global capitalism. It's very, I think, obvious through the pandemic, right? The technological and medical realms are always intersecting with the economic and political ones. And there's a kind of common and very horrifying calculation happening in nations all around the world about whether it's better to let people die from contracting the virus or from the effects of a broken economy, which is somehow worse, which one maybe denies freedom, which one enables more dignity. But in those conversations, that we're always talking about death as a kind of inevitability and as the catastrophe as inevitable, which is another point from the book. And the technologies of health and economy are very linked in this way, right? As catastrophes that consistently enable one another, that might worsen one another in order to save their own death count. Very visceral on the nightly news, which I've never been watching like with such veracity as the last few weeks, right? You have the kind of daily infection counts, death counts, and then right beside them, unemployment rates, stock market data, and now right beside them, the vote counts as well. It seems to be this attempt to like give a very visual and spatial equality to these different catastrophes right on the screen. And I guess to my mind, the tendency to conflate the health catastrophe from the economic comes back again to this question of inevitability that Dr. Nasi warned about in the book, right? What is so dangerous in the equivalence of catastrophes is that they seem to become one long inevitable roll of interconnected crises, which I think the idea of being outraged all the time and what that is able to do is very relevant right now, perhaps more than before, but maybe not. In the book, Dr. Nasi, you proposed that after Fukushima, one response to this was to find a non-simplistic way of thinking the present. And I wonder what that presentness looks like when we're currently living in this hyper disrupted state day to day, constantly like imperiled, either as we're looking for a sense of normalcy, watching loved ones die, or, you know, constantly isolated in these spaces of ourselves, in these little boxes on the screen. And I guess that connects my question to when death is so immensely present in the present, is this the way of thinking death that you're speaking of? Is this one, what is the connection, I guess, between thinking the present and thinking death that you spoke about today? Yeah, okay. So I'm wondering if you can elaborate on that.
Okay, you ask what is the connection between thinking the present and thinking death. Okay, okay. It's not that easy, but this may occur at each time. No? I can't die now or in 1 minute or 1 hour, and certainly a couple of years. So the death is absolutely linked to the present. But what is at the same time, if I could say, or more than at the same time, no, what is, I would say, more essentially linked to the community, to say, of present and death, is something which is called eternity. Eternity doesn't mean a very long time. For that, it is a scholastic term, which is sempiternity. Eternity is something different from sempiternity. Eternity is precisely is a present out of the time. Because what is the present? Present, present is now, but as we know since Aristotle, there is no now. Every now is already past and coming, right? And but between to go and to come, between both, and this between has no space, maybe, or is not, again, is not calculable. But in this between, there is an out of time. Now, sometimes I think that the famous word of Shakespeare, that time is out of joint. But maybe time is out of joint is a very definition of time. The chronological time is going away, but the time, this time about which Kant says that everything is in time, but time itself. What is time itself? Maybe time itself is all the time. Precisely what happens, that is what Proust calls a few time in the pure, Amanda, un peu de temps à l'état pur.
Yeah, a bit of time in a pure state.
Mais un peu de temps à l'état pur, c'est le présent aussi bien du passé peut-être que de l'avenir. C'est quoi? C'est quelque chose que nous connaissons dans la rencontre avec quelqu'un. Même pas seulement de la rencontre amoureuse, mais non, dans la rencontre avec quelqu'un. Dans la rencontre aussi avec une œuvre d'art. Qu'est-ce qui se passe si je suis devant un tableau, un morceau de musique ou un film qui me tient justement, qui me retient dans le présent.
So the idea, what is this experience of time in time, a bit of time in its pure state, is this holding of a moment that in which the past is also in the present and the future perhaps also experienced in the present is the time, for example, of an encounter, of a meeting, and not just an encounter with another person or a romantic moment, but an encounter with a work of art, a painting or a film. It's something that holds us there and therefore is a pure experience of time in a moment, because it collapses those other possibilities into that one moment.
So that means that certainly death has to do with eternity, not because the dead person would live semper eternally, but because at the time of death, it is the last present of this person. He or she is present for the last time. Yes, but each time is the last time. And this is because, this is a reason for what maybe we may die at every moment, but maybe in a certain way, we die at each moment. We disappear, we reappear. Of course, I don't want to say that that everything would be happy with that. No, of course, not only we cannot be happy to die, and we cannot be happy to see the other die, and maybe we are never so happy, if this is a good word. We are never really happy with the eternity. When I am surprised by something that happens, the encounter, the unknown, is it a happiness? No, it's not happiness. Maybe in French the word joy, la joie, would be better, but even this one is, no, that's not true. So I think recently I've seen a film of Bellatar, Satan Tango, which is an extraordinary film, very long, 7 hours and more. But during 7 hours and more, you are almost all the time in the present, almost all the time. But sometimes you have a plan, we say in French, you know, and to stay, you see the same person doing something, but the same thing. But all this time, you are at the same time, a little nervous. Will that be finished? I want to go back. But at the same time, you see that you can see everything in the picture. And it is almost like if the film would stop. Chaos has made me think that Chaos Tami liked to say, I prefer the photo to the film. And in a film, he said, I want to reach the point of the photography. Just something. Otherwise, I did not understand everything you said. So I don't know if it is needed to translate something else. No, thank you.
Maybe we have some time to look back to Michael's answer. If you we could. I mean, there are still 96 participants. So we could also try to take some questions.
There is a question in the chat that just popped up.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so we have. There is one about the talk being made available. Is that an easy one to answer? Yes. And then there is one from Doris Garraway, which I think everybody can see, to return to one of the most central points in the talk.
On peut voir les questions?
Yes.
Oui, c'est dans le chat.
Il faut cliquer sur le chat.
Dans discussion.
Aussi, si, ça doit être ça.
Alors, discussion, ah oui, j'ai Major Reis Reiner, ça c'est à tout le monde.
Oui, Doris Garraway, you see?
Non.
Maybe we can.
The return, après Doris Garraway, c'est ça?
C'est la dernière, oui.
Oui, c'est ça.
The return to one of the most central principles. Do you regard the inculcability of the true value or of the producer as a limitation that problematizes the affirmation of human equality or as a foundation from which to think it? If we imagine this very incalculability beyond measure as proof of the supposition equality, do we need to rethink this? The second question is, but wait, first, I want to answer that the incalculability of the pure value is incalculable precisely because in the production we are in the realm of calculability. So in a way, the question of the plus-value, how we say in English, you say plus-value?
Surplus value. Surplus value.
So maybe this question is a false question. It's not the right question. It is a question for Marx because Marx thought, we should say that, he showed everything in terms of production. And Marx was very happy, as you know, with capitalism, that is with the augmentation of production of everything around the world, etc., etc. So, Marx did belong to his time, that's very normal. but precisely, the question is maybe not the value of the production or of the producer. It is a question of absolute value. And the absolute value is a value of man, of woman, of human being. And it is what we call count dignity. Dignity means in German, I don't remember, Würde. Yeah, die Würde in German, but that is dignity, is a word of the same family as Wert, which is value. You know? So the Würde, the dignity, is an absolute value. What is an absolute value? It is a value, it is not a value. It is a value that cannot be evaluated. In a certain way, I think that when Nietzsche talked about transvaluation of the values, finally, he doesn't think about to make new values or I don't know, to prefer that to that, to prefer red to blue or I don't know, iPhone to BlackBerry. No. I think about to go toward an absolute value, which is maybe by Nietzsche the value belonging to the possibility of the affirmation of the eternal order. But there is something else. So this is what I would answer. And then the question is no longer today, I would say, the question of the value, of the work, of the worker, etc., etc. It is the question of the value of production. And this is even more because the big change in the work today is the change which makes a lot of people going out of the work market because there is no work for them. This big change is precisely a change where the production become more and more autonomous and become the production which can product itself and product and reproduct, etc. etc. Yeah. So precisely at the point where we thought, I would say 10 years, 20 years ago, at the point where we thought that maybe the globalization was opening a place for general communication and then maybe for more value precisely of the exchange between people, we did not understand that it, when it is still production and production of production, then we lose what was for Marx, in a way, the very final point, that is, it was not explicitly for Marx, I know, but I think that more in Hegelian terms. The last point should be the return to the first step, but the first step becoming completely concrete. And the first step, what it is not production, it is a reproduction. It is a life to be at this place doing that and that and that, and not all the time seeking to do more, to get more, etc., etc. So, sorry, I'm too long. And then we need to rethink death, of course, because precisely we have to rethink, let's say, the value of death. Everybody would say the value of death is zero. No value. Yes, it is absolutely no value in the terms of production, but at the time of death, we know that, in a way very well at the time of death, and so particularly when the death is not by accident, crime, etc. At the time of death, then we grasp something of the value of the dead person. You know, it is well known that at the time of death, a lot of praise of the dead person are made, and frequently we think, yes, the praise are not very sincere. No, but okay, it's true. But the time of the death is the time of praise, and praise is a recognition of the absolute, definitive value or dignity of the person. Now think, for example, in Proust, remember the death of Bergotte. And so Bergotte is dead, and Proust writes, but he was still living through all the candles at the store, all the candles before his books, etc. Well, so it's just precisely a burning candle that is the eternity of present, but how it is easy to say what I say, that it is too easy. The question is how we may make with that something concrete, something I would say that would be as concrete as was maybe the discourse about death in the old Christian people, and in many other old people. Well, and then Veronica Grossi, I have a question. Did Hegel bring the value of work before Marx in The Slave and His Work? No. Yes, if you want, we can say that the one which is called The Slave, which is not The Slave, which is, I don't know, comment on dit, le valet?
A servant.
The servant.
The
slave. Nevertheless. But for Hegel, it is not exactly the question of production, not of production. Of course, it is a question of producing, if you want, what is necessary for life. And then the servant gives what the master needs to live. Okay, but it is, for Hegel, it is only that. That is, there is not the thinking about the growing of the production. It is not said that the servant would have to would think, would even think to produce more and make some benefit more in the back of the master. No, nothing about it.
Okay, so I think there are no more questions, and maybe we can, it's been 2 hours, so maybe we can just close the event. I would like to thank you, all the participants, of course, Jean-Luc Nancy, also Michael Hart, Melissa Carr for the wonderful responses, and Amanda for her translation. And I was very glad, in fact, there are just some points I would like to very, very quickly go back, but I was very glad that that Melissa mentioned Jean-Luc Nancy's essay on Fukushima, and I think that's an important one, and one that can also help us.
Oh yes, yes, you talk about this book.
Yeah,
the end of the book, I wrote that it should be a communism of inequivalency. Yeah. And you know, the greatest communist of our time, that is Alain Badiou, told me, I agree with you.
Good.
So I have the benediction of the main communist.
Just would like to say some things, and I would like to go back to this comment that Michael made about the corruption of
yes, I see the question.
Yeah, the corruption, and I was going to say there's of course, and all of those concepts which are inherently related to the notion of equality. You can think democracy, freedom, universalism would be another one, and one which has been deeply corrupted and deeply trapped into not only unproductive but dangerous forms of binary oppositions. And I think that's a huge task we have ahead of us and that's something that Jean-Luc Nancy has been doing for decades, but that we still have within our share, we have to continue doing it because those are very, very urgent times. I just would like to respond to the response. And I was thinking about one thing.
But it was a question about Derrida's seminar on life and death. Should I answer?
There's another one. Okay, bye. Yeah, of course. I will wrap up?
Oh, very briefly, because it would be a...
I think you should take the question that's more important.
So what is very significant in this seminar of Derrida is in a way simply that he created this expression, la vie, la mort, in English, life, death, avec un trait d'union.
It has a dash, so it's life.
That is to take together life and death. So, I can't say more because it would be too much, and maybe I could not say very much. So, I think it is a very, very important to think that death belongs to life, and that life belongs to death. And maybe that comes from Heidegger. I would say the formula of Derrida, which is very good, is a way of switching a little and developing in another form the to be to death of Heidegger. A majority of people understood that Heidegger said, we are destined to death. Absolutely not. The to be to death, which is not, I don't know how it is in English, because in French it was translated as l'être pour la mort, being for death. This is absolutely not the meaning of the German sein zum Tod. Zum is not for, it is toward, it is going toward.
In English it's being towards death, I think, the translation, some translations of Heidegger.
Je ne sais pas comment est-ce qu'on dit le lettre pour la mort.
Ouais, en anglais ça donne lettre vers la mort.
Ah oui, alors ça c'est mieux. C'est mieux, peut-être, oui, faire. Oui, là, de ce point de vue, of this point of view, Heidegger was very badly read and understood, but it is partly his fault because later than being in time, he becomes what we know. So we don't speak about Heidegger now.
I think we can, you know, just close. It's difficult to end, I think, a talk like that, or a conversation like that. It could be an infinite conversation, if I may refer to Blanchot. But I think we have to end. And thank you very much for all of you. And I think you have some. If you look at the chat, Jean-Luc, you have some comments which are very beautiful comments and messages, which I think you should read.
Well, thank you to everybody, thank you to you, Al-Gaël, thank you to Michael Hart and Messi Kakar, and thank you, Amanda. Vous avez été parfaite.
C'était un grand plaisir, vraiment.
Merci.